Welcome, thank you for coming to my show. I chose the topic Free Forms, Finding Repurpose. The theme of the show is to reflect upon reusing items that are past their prime, might be thrown away, might have had a completely different purpose and are no longer being used for that purpose. And rather than hitting the trash heap, I want to find a way to reclaim the items and give them new life, and sometimes in a humorous and original way. This piece is called Golden Tickets, and the reason I think of these as golden tickets is because they were secured through the Hamilton Lottery, and that was special because they are lucky tickets. They are $10. They are front row seats to the best show or the best musical that I've ever seen, and we've gotten to enjoy it several times, and this is two sets of tickets from two different occasions. The tickets themselves are encased in plastic, actually clear laminate, and then they are crocheted with golden lurex thread. And the playbills, it took three playbills to collage into this one piece, which has got sequins and seed beads and peyote stitching all around it. And the tickets are held up by a peyote stitch beadwork glove that is three-dimensional because it is stuffed, filled with polyfill, and the whole thing is supported on a Declaration of Independence, which I thought was just the perfect backdrop for this piece.
I was wondering, when you did this work, did you know ahead of time exactly what you were going to do? Do you sketch it out, or is it more of organic?
It's organic, yes. I do it a piece at a time. I really, as I worked on the glove took months, because I worked on many different things at the same time. So it takes a long time for me to finish a piece. But in having 6 or 10 projects even going at a time, something's always getting done. But it started with the glove. I really didn't know how I was going to get it to hold the tickets. I really didn't even think about the Declaration of Independence until I was done, you know, with the other components. So these two pieces are standing box art. I wanted to I'll show you some of the components of this. So this bottom one starts with this Ferrero Rocher box, and then this is just a Martha Stewart punch. So what I've done is punch round paper circles to put into each of the cells of the gold background. And then within each cell, there are silver washers that outline the cells, and pearls that go on top of the washers. And then these are worm shells that were collected on the beach at Sanibel. And in addition to some worm shells, there's some pieces of coral. And when I was on that trip, my goal was only to find those kinds of shells. And whenever I've traveled to Sanibel a couple times, and each time I kind of hone in on some oddball shell. One time I picked up all scallop shells, but not whole ones, only ones that were rectangularly eroded. So that was my goal on that trip, and then eventually I was able to work it into the candy box, and this is called Beach Candy. This one is just it's just a wooden box with, there's some resin in there, some buttons, some pearls, and with the gold background from the candy box. This piece over here is called Plum Crazy Window Treatments. And it started with a photo mat. So I was up in the attic cleaning out some things, and there was a mat that used to house individual photos in each cell. And what I decided to do was to turn each one into a miniature weaving. And the way I did that was punch little tiny holes into each cell so that I could string a warp, and then once I could string a warp through those holes, I could then weave right into the mat itself. And as an inspiration for each of these little pieces, I used, here are some designs that just came from a cross-stitch book. I'm going to tell you, I belong to this organization of fiber artists called the Surface Design Association, and we have something at our meetings called a swap table, And that means people just bring in art materials or resource materials that they no longer need in their studio, and we just go for it. And we all go home with other people's cast-offs, and you're going to hear me talk about the swap table in a number of pieces around the room. But this book of cross-stitch designs came from that swap table. A lot of these geometric designs come from weaving books. So I started my career as a weaver, working on a multi-harness loom. And these are, if you know much about weaving, these are weaving drafts. But I'm using them now to be designs for geometric beadwork. And that's where these other, the purple beadwork designs came from. So the yin and yang would be something that came from the cross stitch book, and then the geometric ones would be what came from the weaving drafts. This piece, I think I'm probably the only artist that's ever been able to hang a piece in this corner. So, if you've ever ordered a used book from Amazon and it came in such a pitiful condition, this is what you might have done with it. So, this book, A Prayer from Owen Meany, I ordered used because my book club selected this book, and it is in such bad shape, the pages are falling out, I couldn't even re-donate it. So, it came to this. So, the way this is constructed is each piece is rolled, probably around a dowel, I think I used at the time. Each page is rolled. And then each page, then this is spackle tape. I don't know if you've ever seen tape that looks like this, but I use it very frequently in my work. Each page is then stitched into the spackle tape. And then it is, once I had that whole long strip of pages all rolled and stitched, I adhere them to a long strip of wood. And then in each coil, there's just one strip of one length of lurex thread. So starting at the top, there's a gold thread through it that goes all the way to the bottom. And so each successive roll of paper has a thread in it. So as you go down, it builds. So it gets thicker and thicker as you go towards the bottom. Any questions on the gold wall? Anyway, anybody need some pages? This is Sunny Side Up, and it is completely hand embroidered, and it started because the spatula had seen better days. So if you look at the back, you can see the spatula was cracked. So what I did was just, I guess on the internet, got an image of an egg and then drew it onto a fabric called Lacy Stiff Stuff and then slowly embroidered it. So that's how this came to be.
That would go nicely with the frying pan, it sounds like.
Yeah.
I know. Frying pan. For anybody who didn't see it in the shop downstairs, there's a beautiful frying pan by Dick Ivany that is made of wood with a metal handle. Where can you cook with that? You could cook this with that. This is another swap table piece. So on the swap table was this book, which comes from, it's from 1966, and it's called The Work Basket. And it's a little pamphlet that I guess households would get in their homes, and it was really focused on women's attention, on the attention of women. So I took some of these very dated pages and honed in on something that was some words that called out to me from each of the pages. So the pages were then collaged onto, this is like a faux leather, I'm sure it's not real leather, but I have a roll of it from a tag sale. So they're collaged onto this faux leather, and then, this is, never scrub, everyone's favorite, never scrub your toilet again. So, on that, you see the toilet. So, after they were collaged, I used bead embroidery to execute the designs that are on the pages themselves. And then, the pages are
are connected to each other with zippers.
The
and
body
then
work
and between the upper and lower lines of pages are crochet, navy blue crochet. So that's how that piece was done.
Very slick.
Another question. Is there some kind of overarching part of you or philosophy that draws you to using cast off objects and things of that kind?
I have a few overarching themes. One is pop culture. I want to memorialize my lifetime and the things that have, you know, that I experienced as well as the things my children have experienced. So I guess I would say that. I also am very fond of attribution art, so a lot of what I do will be in response to the work of other artists. This next group, these are my 1001 abstracts, it's called, because they're executed on art cards that I picked up at a show, I think it was at the Farmington Valley Art Center. Within each of those art cards, there are 1,000 little white squares, which you can't see now because they're covered with seed bead embroidery. But there's 1,000 squares, and then there's one more square at the bottom. So there are 1,001 abstracts. So within each square, there's two beads. So in each of these pieces, there are 2,000 beads. Again, the designs came from the drafts from the weaving books. When you have children and they move out, a lot of times their materials and things do not move with them. My daughter Marlise is here. These were her garbage pail kids. They made it down from the attic, but they didn't make it out of the house. They made down from the attic to the studio. And so each one is set inside, these are save-a-day food trays. And the garbage pail kids are collaged on always credit cards, but the little cards that represent credit cards, or it could be an expired credit card, that I collect when they come in the mail, or as they, you know, or a hotel key or something of that is that 2.5 or 3 by 2 card. So the garbage pail stickers are collaged onto that and they are stitched into the food tray. And then, well, before that happens, there's crochet all around the card. And then it's because of the crochet border, I'm able to stitch it into the food tray. And then the food trays are then stitched to each other. And I think there, let's see, 49 of them. That's a massacre. The next piece, talk about, this is Paddlehead, and this is an example of paying homage to Jean-Michel Basquiat. And he was, this is a portrait I did of him. It might be familiar to some of you who might not otherwise, the name might not mean as much as the photograph does. So this is a wooden paddle that was in the studio, and this is Basquiat's King of the Zulus. It's excerpt, I think we were at a gallery show and I took just a snapshot of something within a larger work of his. And then the way I did it was to print that and then glue it or collage it to the wood, and then there's a seed bead on top of the paddle. This next group I like to call product placement, and there's a couple of different techniques here. Some of this is woven, some of it is collaged, and some of it is just beadwork. So this Coca-Cola bottle is, it started in the Museum of Modern Art when we got a Coca-Cola with our lunch, and it's one of those aluminum cans underneath, and it is peyote stitch beadwork that starts at the top and goes circularly all around, all the way to the bottom, and then there's a little bit of a bead mosaic on the top.
The reason that we have the animal this is a collaged box from the animal crackers. This was the year that they were uncaged. So before this, they were in cages on the box. And my girlfriend had bought these for her her grandchildren and mentioned it to me, and I'm like, I want to memorialize the change. So it takes three boxes to do one of these. Again, I'm cutting vertically, horizontally, and adhering. So I have to have two other boxes plus your base box. The same technique was used on the Leander Lakes. Now this is plain and peanut M&Ms mixed together. So it took two packages, one woven into the other, and then beads are glued on top of it. And then the way the soup can is done is with labels that are flat. So first they have to be soaked off, which, let me say, there's a lot of wasted cans of soup when the labels come off easily, but fortunately I do like to drink this. So it is two labels, one woven into the other. And then what that creates is, you know, you've got that overlap of the woven paper. Then I can then go in with a needle and thread full of beads and go in and out and do the bead weaving into the label that's already been woven. And in this case, I also put resin on the top, so no little fingers can pop it. I was a little nervous that that might happen. Somebody might just get curious. So that's product placement. You'll see another one in the far corner, which is the Rice Krispies box. Thank you, Mark. Which is, the reason I didn't know it at the time, but since that time that I've done that box, those are super-sized BJ's boxes, they've now changed the characters.
Oh, yeah.
They've made them darker, they've made them pointier, so from time to time, the images do change, and now I feel like I at least have the one that I grew up with still, you know, still on that box. Marlise wore this shirt when she was 12 years old. So we still had it. I had to reclaim it from the mice. I had to oxy-clean the heck out of it. And now, it's all embroidered. So it's seed bead embroidery, it's thread embroidery throughout. Matt Groening's signature was on it. It was 1989. But anyway, here, if you look at the bottom, you can actually see what the original t-shirt looks like. You know, it's just a lot bigger than the original t-shirt now. So. My next piece is crystal clear. And I think, you know, within this show, this is one of my favorites. And this is a recent piece. And Neil and I were in Rome, and I picked this motorcycle mirror up off the street. It was fractured unbelievably, but somehow the glass just stayed in place. It didn't fall apart. It went into my pocket, it went into my suitcase, it went into my studio. And so I wanted to treat it like a bezel, like you would see in jewelry where you know, have a stone and you put it down onto some fabric and you embroider around it. So that was the concept. So I built the beads up around the side so that they could house the motorcycle mirror, and then worked concentrically around, always knowing I just wanted to stick with silver and black and crystal. And then, of course, adding crystal buttons and other things to give it a more interesting shape. And then after that was all the bead work was done, I just took sewing thread and went into every bead that hit the edge and just, you know, did a fringe, you know, all around the work. I had bingo cards, and you know, each component was probably just a couple hours. And then all of a sudden I had a bunch of them, so I decided to frame them all together. But interestingly, while I was working on this piece, like I work in isolation, nobody really knows what I'm working on at any given time. But one of my girlfriends called me or emailed me. She lives down in Norwalk, and she said, you know, I went to a flea market and I found something I think you're going to like. And I sent it in the mail, Now, what comes in the mail? Red bingo cards. Well, I was working on this, and I was like, oh my gosh, how did you know? You found the right person. So there is a red bingo piece, too, and I'll talk a little more about it when I get there. But Francine was definitely channeling me while I was working on this. But I just, you know, these are just really clip art images, basically, you know, internet, you know, searches that give me an ability to then transfer the image to the card, and then using either bead embroidery or regular embroidery or markers and sequins just to give them a little more life. I really, you know, this is something that I feel is my life, you know, the things that are, have, you know, been important in my life.
When were you in jail?
What I would do is just put the leftover paint onto the cardboard and let it push the plastic down and then let it extrude through. And so this piece probably took a couple of years because of, you know, just waiting for enough leftover paint. And then, you know, I finished it by doing a weaving, a fiber weaving to create the grid for each of the circles. This piece also is wired to be hung, horizontally, the way it's wired. So this is another homage piece. This is an homage to Keith Haring. If people know who Keith Haring is, he's a graffiti artist, or was. He was also very active in the AIDS, as an AIDS advocate, or cure for AIDS. But anyway, his designs were like this. And then this is also a design. These are two of his other designs. And then this is the flag that's actually underneath that. And then I've put it's like cross-stitch canvas onto it. I've done the designs on the cross-stitch canvas and then put them on the flag and then put them, you know, in the bottle. The bottle is filled with heavy metal pieces just so it's not tippy. This wine bottle was in my studio for about, I'm gonna say 15, 20 years. Somebody, my brother-in-law gave me the wine bottle and it just had the greatest shape.
Yeah.
And I saved it. So what I did was figure out a way to adhere some cartoons. We call them cartoons as the underlying design to each face of the bottle, and then just beaded over it from top to bottom. So this is another. These are credit cards. These are shredded, and then it's just an abstract landscape. It's not just credit cards, but there's JCPenney's in here. There's some BJ's cards. There's, you know, just I don't know. $5 off here or there. And if I didn't have the right color, I did do a little painting on some of these, just to kind of fill in together, you know, just an overall kind of an abstract landscape look. This is Eastern View, and this is a fairly complicated piece. It started with a metal grate that came from a heater, and without getting too technical, I beaded each of these spokes in order to have a structure that I could thread through. And in threading it, I could then weave beads into it. So by creating this, I was able to warp each section with thread. And then once that was all warped, I could do, starting on an end, just keep weaving the design across the piece. Sergeant Peggy's Lonely Hearts Club Band. This piece is from 2007, and it is the actual album from the Lonely Hearts Club. I have, again, embroidered it in the center with my name instead of Pepper's. And then the piece is, you know, it's completely bead mosaic with a lot of added elements, little dolls and little ceramic heads, and it has the faces of famous people. You can see Bob Dylan, you can see W.C. Fields, you can see Shirley Temple, of course the Beatles are in there, Marlon Brando. Those heads are all there's a polymer substance that I put on the heads before I put them back onto the album. This is a double album, and when you open, and it's actually on the album itself, when you open this up, you have the whole, the portraits of the Beatles inside. And this is, when I made this piece, I also did the beaded portrait of them. And again, this was, I think, 2007, 2008. So I did no longer own this, but that was one of my all-time favorite pieces.
What were your favorite pieces? Mm-hmm. The ones that always sell.
Sometimes, yeah.
Always leave you.
Yeah. And you know, I look at some and I go, I don't think I could do that again. One and done. All right, so now we're to the, this is called Behind Bars. And I just wanted to talk a little bit about how this is done, because people seem to think I put the boxes over the picture, but it's the opposite. The pictures are cut into little squares and collaged into each of the boxes. And that is how that piece is done. And then this is the Giving Tree. And it was a thank you card that I got from somebody. And then it's just got seed bead embroidery on it. And then peyote stitch beadwork around the edge. And then sewing thread finished at the bottom. And Retail Therapy. Now these are Kohl's cards, not only Kohl's cards, but Gap cards, or when you get them in the mail, they're the shape of a credit card. And then what I've done is successively, I think I took eighth of an inch off each side, and again and again and again and again until I built them up like in contour. So I also thought about calling it percent off everything, because that's what a lot of them say, and it's actually a little percent off each card itself. So, and then when you have a box of hairpins that you don't know what to do with, you turn them into warps. These are all different hairpins. These tool canvases came off the swap table. So I had six canvases, and four of them wound up in this piece of weaving done on bobby pins. And then I talked already about the Rice Krispies images, and this is two boxes, one woven into the other. This is purely woven. To do this, I have to flatten it out, and then cut it, and then cut a second box and weave it into it. Once I've done the whole weaving, I weave fiber in as well, and then I reattach and put the box back together. So. All right, almost there, guys. Thank you for sticking with me. Little Women, again, this is a small, these are recycled art cards. So if I, if I go to an art show, or I go to a museum or anywhere where they have artists who leave their art cards, I do collect those. They're harder to come by now than they have been in the past. But I have boxes and boxes of them. So I went through and I tried to find images of women in different poses, or some of them are pretty bizarre looking women, but there's a de Kooning here. There's some real odd ones. But anyway, I turned the credit cards into a loom by notching them, and then wrapping the fiber around. Then I could weave the Little Women pieces into the credit card. Once the credit card weaving was done, then I peyote stitched a border around it, peyote stitched beadwork. Then I used the beadwork to stitch it into the food trays, which I had already painted white. And then the food trays were stitched together. That's Little Women. This piece, this is a paper weaving, and it's a collaboration with my girlfriend Linda Pearson, and she does the colored pencil drawings, and when she wants to test her pencils, she uses scrap paper. So she had two scrap papers full of pencil marks, and that's what we used for this this paper weaving. And it's it looked very confetti-like to me, so that's what I called it. And then the final piece,
some of you have probably played on this or played this game, Parcheesi. And this piece did take me a long time because I started the home, the center home, probably 15 years ago, I'm not sure. It was one of those things where I started it and I'm like, ooh. It is embroidery with sewing thread, and it was taking forever, and I had a full-time job, and I just shelved it. I didn't even remember I had it. But now I'm retired, and I found it. So I picked it up again, and I finished the center section, and then I added a lot more beadwork rather than sewing thread, and then decided to do a mosaic around on top of the board. You know, in weaving, there's a term when you start a weaving and you dress your loom and you start working on it and you just hate it. Or not hate the work, but what did I do? How am I ever going to get this done? It's called a dog on the loom. Well, that's how I thought about this home piece, was this is a dog on the loom. But anyway, once it was done, then I'm like, the rest was just tedious gluing. But I, so the elements of the original board, this is an original board underneath, of course, and then these are pieces that would actually go with the game. And then I didn't, you know, I had these metal letters around, I don't know where I got them, but it spells Parcheesi as you go around, starting here, it spells Parcheesi back down to the I on the bottom. So that's my show.
Wow.
You started with fabric weaving and then transitioned to bead weaving?
Yes, I was a tapestry weaver. I had an 8-harness production loom. Are you familiar with weaving? I had an 8-harness production loom, and that was 45 inches wide. And I had a 60-inch tapestry loom, which I just got rid of about 2 or 3 months ago. So I wasn't doing that much of it anymore. The last thing I did was a rug on my tapestry loom for my daughter. My grandson was born, and he's now 8. So it's like 8 years I haven't used this loom. So what I've done is migrated to bead looms mostly. There was a point in the early 90s where I did a traditional tapestry and took the same design and did it as a bead weaving and thought, I like this better. And that was really kind of a watershed moment where I moved more exclusively to beads. I can still do off loom weaving or cardboard loom weaving, and I still have a small loom at home. But yeah.
And do you use glass, plastic? Are you particular about your beads, or do you?
Glass. Okay. Yeah, they're glass. Almost all beads are glass, unless you're looking at pony beads or something like that. But yeah. And I like to use a size 11. There's a sizing, but a seed bead is about a size 11. But I will vary that a little bit, and I will get beads all over the world. I will drag Neil to the bead stores. Because I need a variety of color. I need a variety of tones, because I like to get graduated shadows and things like that, especially with these portraits. So, I have, I'd say, a full wall in my studio of these big, the plastic pretzel containers, full of like, maybe here's a one full of red beads and one full of blue beads, etc. So I have them sorted by color. And people give me beads that they inherit. Recently, somebody I was in a show with had 5 years ago inherited somebody's mother's beads, and she never was going to use them, and I got a box of big, and it was like Christmas to me. So I spent all day going through those beads and sorting them by color and being very happy.
Are the beads strung from the needle one at a time in a row?
Depends on the technique. A mosaic is picked up one bead at a time with glue. Mm-hmm. Right. So what I'll do is I have my everything's all spread out in front of me. But I'll put the tiniest dab of glue on the head of a pin and use it to pick up the bead and just keep moving it over like that.
Are you just placing it?
Placing it. First, this is the right. These are glued. Weavings are woven. And if it's a weaving, the beads are strung in a line and woven in.
You string them first and weave them second.
Yes. Yes. So, for instance, the heater, the grate, the heater grate, he's Eastern View. That's a weaving. So there'll be a whole line of beads that I'll put in at a time. I'll pick it up off a graph. You know, I have it all graphed out, and then I can, you know, say I need 10 blue and 1 tan and 3 white. Pick up the whole row, and then each bead sits between 2 threads as I go across the row. But mosaics are glued.
But by hand, not with a loom.
That I turned
lifting
that.
Lifting the weft.
Bead loom doesn't have.
Right.
You don't lift the threads.
She has
They're
some
flat.
Great videos on YouTube.
Yeah, I do have video
channels.
How-tos on that on YouTube, how to do it. I can demonstrate. I can, you know, I can certainly demonstrate. And I think I have actually demonstrated here once, but. I do a lot of different techniques, a lot of embroidery as well. I do bead mosaics, embedding them into polymer clay. So it depends, you know, each technique has a different process. So, yes.
How did a peyote stitch get its name?
I'm going to say Native American. I don't know.
At a peyote ceremony.
There you go. I think there's other names for it too, but it's the name I know. Thank you for your interest. I really do appreciate it.
Thank you. You're remarkable.